I want to talk to you this morning on the subject, how to invest in forever. Now, today's message, I'm going to tell you right up front, is about giving. Okay, it's about giving. And that's probably outside of some other of the social issues that are going around in our country right now, there's probably no topic that is any more controversial or more negatively associated with churches than this topic. Probably not. In fact, one of the reasons every Sunday I say every Sunday when we are getting ready to take the offering, I say, if there are any guests here today, we're so glad you're here. Please don't feel pressure to give in our offering. The reason I say that every single week is because if you talk to people about why they don't go to church, what's one of the number one things they say?
They want my money.
They want my money. Yeah. They're always after money. Always got their hand out. It's just corrupt. It's just they're all about money. And this church is not about that. But the problem is, when people come in, maybe you feel like that's what your church experience has been other places. And so it can be a touchy subject. And today, I'm going to talk to you about the topic of giving, but I hope to do it in such a way that you understand that the reason some churches ask for money is because they've got to fund their multi-million-dollar building. The reason some churches ask for money is because they want to fund the pastor's lavish lifestyle and his Italian suits and his private jet. But the reason that Jesus asks you to give is not any of those things. The reason that we ask you to give, I want the reason our church says we want people to give to be the same reason that Jesus wants people to give. Am I making sense here? I want those two reasons to line up and be the same thing. And so today I want to talk to you about giving, and I want to do it out of Luke chapter 16. This is a story that when I was a kid, frankly, was very confusing to me. And it might be to you also. So I'm gonna start in, and I want to try to just go through the story, and then I'm going to back up, and I'm going to explain the story from start to finish. So let's jump into Luke chapter 16, and starting in verse 1 on your handout. Jesus told his disciples, "There was a rich man whose manager was accused of wasting his possessions." So, wealthy man, he's got a financial manager, kind of a guy he's put over his businesses and his books and his farm, and you know, he's kind of, the guy's a financial manager, but he's not doing well, apparently. Somebody's found out there's some unwise things going on. So he called him in, and he said, "What is this I hear about you? Give an account of your management, because you cannot be manager any longer." The manager said to himself, "What shall I do now? My master is taking away my job. I'm not strong enough to dig, and I'm ashamed to beg." He's been more of a managing type worker. He's not a tough enough guy to go out and work manual labor and dig ditches or whatever. And he's ashamed to be a beggar. What is he supposed to do? Now, apparently, what the master did, the rich man did, is he said, I'm going to give you 30 days or 60 days or 90 days or whatever to get all of the accounts together, to get everything organized, to take care of business, pay off bills, figure out what our balances are, and then you're done. Apparently, he's given him, like, you've got a certain amount of time to get things together so I know where things are and I can hand over the books to somebody else. So then he said, "I'm ashamed to beg," verse 4, "I know what I will do next. I know what I'll do next. So that when I lose my job here, people will welcome me into their houses." So he called each one of his master's debtors in, and he asked the first one, "How much do you owe my master?" 800 gallons of olive oil," he replied. The manager told him, "Take your bill, sit down quickly, and make it 400. Oh. we're editing invoices after the fact here. You know, he's like, hey, listen, let's cut a deal. All right, let's cut a deal. Very dishonest, unacceptable, right? I wouldn't want this guy working for me, right? Then he asked the second one, how much do you owe? 1,000 bushels of wheat, he replied. And he told him, take your bill and write it instead for 800. Now verse 8, the master commended the dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly. Now, the master, I don't think the master was like, hey, great job, you stole my money. That's not what he's saying. What is the master commending him for? I think this is more like the master saying, oh, you're smart. We got your authorized signature and that guy's authorized signature on a bill. I know he owed me 800, but you made it 4. You're smart, man. You're smart. Get out of here. Okay, I think that's what he's commending him, not because he did something honest, but because he was smart. Now let's look on what it says next. The master commended the dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly, for the people of this world are more shrewd in dealing with their own kind than are the people of light. I tell you, use worldly wealth to gain friends for yourselves so that when it is gone, you will be welcomed into eternal dwellings. Whoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much, and whoever is dishonest with very little will also be dishonest with much. So if you have not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? What he's saying is that money, in some measure, money is a test and a trust. While we're on this earth, it's a test and a trust. How do you do with this? Let's see how you do with this. Can you handle this? Can you handle this? So when your paycheck comes in every week, God's saying, can you handle that? What do you do with this? How about this? If you have not been trustworthy with your own, with someone else's property, who will give you property of your very own? No servant can serve two masters. Either he will hate the one and love the other, or he'll be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. The Pharisees who loved money heard this and were sneering at Jesus. All right. Now Jesus' story, here's the reason this story just blew me away as a kid. I thought that Jesus was approving of this guy's dishonesty. I was like, is this the same God that said you shall not lie? Because this guy just totally lied and changed some things. And that's not, no, Jesus is not intending to approve his dishonesty, but he is giving an example comparing shrewd behavior, knowing three things, and I'm going to talk about what those three things are, with the behavior that, what if we as Christians knew those same three things about our money, okay? Let's look at it. I want to see if I can explain what three things the dishonest manager did right. Here we go. Number one, are you ready? On your handout. He realized that his time was limited. He realized that his time was limited. You see, this guy had already lost his job. It was a done deal. Like the guy had already said, get the books together. Get the books together because in 30 days or 60 days or 90 days, you're done. All right, you're done. Get the books together. Or maybe it was only 1 week. I don't know exactly how long the guy had. But the guy said, the master says, get the books in order. Figure out, get all the bills organized. And check the balances of everything so I can hand your job to somebody else because you're done, man. You're done. The guy knew that his time was limited. It wasn't like he could change it. It wasn't like he could extend his time. He was going to be fired. It was done. So as quick as he could get his stuff together, he's got a short period of time and then he's out. Now, if that's the case, he's got a choice that he's facing. He's got control of all his master's money and all his master's goods. What's he going to do with it for the next, let's say it's 30 days. What's he going to do with it for the next 30 days? He could say, you know what? I'm going to party. I mean, I am going to party. We're going to blow the doors off. I'm calling everybody. Y'all come over. This tonight, my master's supposed to be out and he's going to town. We are going to drink up everything in his cellar. I hope you guys are prepared. Don't bring anything. Don't bring anything. Just come and come hungry. Don't eat anything all day because we are going to eat, man. We're going to live it up. We're going to party. Why? Because I've got a short period of time. Might as well live it up. He could have done that, right? But this guy knew that although his time, that his time was limited, he wasn't going to be there forever. Now, you and I both know, ultimately, we know this to be true, that our time is limited. You're not going to be in this world forever, I promise you. You guys that are, how old are you again, Austin? You're 14. Austin's 14. Your time, I know you feel, when you're 14, you feel like you are bulletproof, man. You guys are, you're growing up, you feel like, man, I think I'm going to be around forever. You know, you don't like sit down and think about, you know, my life's going to end. Nobody does that and sit around just thinking about that when you're young. But this guy was wise. One of the reasons he was shrewd is because he knew that his time was limited. And I would tell you, for me and for you, that a crucial, crucial thing for being able to wisely handle your money is understanding that your time is limited. And that dollar right there, I will look at it differently if I know that my time is limited. If I know that I'm not going to be here forever, that dollar means something different, like it changes your perspective. Some people say, time's limited, let's party. Right? That's the way they do it. Hey, time's limited. We have no promise of tomorrow. Eat, drink, and be merry. Right? That's what some people do. But this guy didn't do that. Instead, he decided to make friends with the little time that he had. Make friends so that next, when this time was over, there'd be people ready to like, oh, I remember you. You helped me. Come on in. He knew that his time was limited. When was the last time that you sat down in your life and you looked at all the things you have and maybe all the list of things that you have yet to buy that you'd still like to have, and you sat down and thought about it like this: I was not made for all of this. When I die, all of this will go to someone else. And they may not want it. That's so true. A while back, I had a neighbor that passed away, back a few years ago. And that neighbor that passed away, her family came into town, and they sat down, and they went through everything. We went through, we helped them, we went through the house. And we helped them do a garage sale, and we sold almost everything. And they put a few things into their car, took it back home. And then the things they couldn't fit in their car, they had a few pieces of furniture, a couple of pieces of furniture, little small things, and a few like antique things and a few photo albums. And they put them in boxes and left them in the garage of the house and said, we're going to hopefully come back and get these. It's been a while. It's been a couple, 3 years since that happened. And a while back they said, you know what, I was talking to them on the phone. They called and said, you know what, just don't worry about it. You know that stuff that we had said, just don't worry about it. You live your whole life. My neighbor that passed away was in her 90s. You live your whole life. And at the end of the day, everything you worked for and everything you saved is in a yard sale. Everything you thought was valuable, everything you worked your fingers to the bone for, it's in a yard sale. And people are like, yeah, you know, I thought maybe I would want that, but never mind. And that's where things are. Number two, second reason he was smart was he knew that the money wasn't his. He knew the money wasn't his. He knew his time was limited. He knew the money was not his. Now, this sounds like he's making bad business deals here, but it's not causing him any pain whatsoever. Am I making sense? He's sitting down. He's like, 800? Man, cut that in half. Let's go 400. It didn't hurt him. It wasn't his money. He's like, this is painless. Oh, here, you have 400 gallons. Here, you have 200 bushels of wheat. Here, you have some. Oh, no problem. What's happening? He's giving away other people's money. Anybody ever noticed how generous you can be when you're doing it with other people's money? Or a credit card, that's true, but it's Visa's money, I suppose. When you're doing generosity with somebody else's money, it is not so painful, is it? Not really. Now, if you're doing generous with your own money and you view it that way, you're like, oh, I wonder what I can spare this week. But if you're doing it with somebody else's money, you're like, here. You know how I know this? Congress. The U.S. government. You ever noticed how generous they are with your money? Yeah, they're like, sure, $150 toilet seats in the Pentagon. No problem. You know, sign me up for like 5,000 of them. You know, that's the way it goes. Because they're being generous with somebody else's money. There's no pain involved. Now, what if you viewed your money, made a shift in your mind, and viewed your money differently? If you ever say, you know, it's tough to really be generous, maybe it's because you view the money as yours. Have you ever considered maybe that the shift from stinginess or greed or pain when you're giving and the difficulty of giving is because I view this money as mine and I worked for it and I have to be careful and I have to watch out for it? If you made the mental shift to say it doesn't belong to me anyway, would that be an easier thing to do? Would it be easier to give? I had a friend one time who took me out to eat in an expensive steakhouse. I say expensive. I think it was Texas Roadhouse. That's expensive in my budget. And so it's like the place I go, like, you know, on my birthday or whatever. That's like that's once a year type deal, right? And so you go and I ordered. So he said, man, get whatever you want. So I got a big old rack of ribs, man, because that's the way it goes. And so. So I'm sitting there, and I'm kind of feeling bad, honestly. I'm like, man, that's like $24 or something for this rack of ribs. Now, don't get me wrong, it was good. But I was feeling a little bad, and then he happened to mention that he had some property. He was from out of town. He's a extended family member. I'm not very connected, all right? And he said, a while back, he said, I had a company that tried to cheat me out of some drilling rights on my property, and he said it finally just came through, and I got the check, $100,000 check the other day, and I stopped feeling bad immediately. $22. Who cares for $22 if there's a check? You know why? Because now I'm being generous to myself with somebody else's money. Not bothering me, man. This is pretty good. My enjoyment in the ribs went up like this. Giving is hard. Unless the money's not yours. Now, if you make that shift in your mind, I think this is why Jesus said, this guy's smart. This guy was shrewd in dealing with this because he knew his time was limited, but he didn't party it up. He knew the money wasn't his, so he was free to be generous. And then thirdly, the third reason he was smart is he thought long term. He thought long term. He had this thought: what is going to happen to me when I leave this job? Who's going to take care of me when I'm fired? When I leave this job, who's going to make, is there anybody who's going to be like, hey, come over here, man, how you doing? I heard you got fired. Man, I'm so sorry about that. Would you like to stay at my place for a while? Maybe I can hook you up with, you know what, he wanted somebody. Who's going to be looking out for me when I'm walking down the street when this job is done? Because I know it's ending. who's going to be looking out for me when I walk down the street? And Jesus commends him for this kind of thinking. He wasn't commending him because he was dishonest. He was commending him because he knew the money wasn't his and he wasn't going to last long. And so he knew he better think long term instead of short term. He didn't say, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to polish and wax my high performance chariot. You know, and I'm gonna have my horse. I'm gonna buy some horses and groom them up real nice, and they're gonna shine in the light. He didn't live for those kinds of things. You know why? Because when the job was done, it was all gonna go back to the boss. All of it went back to the boss anyway. And so instead, he said, "How can I make friends after I leave here?" I would tell you this, there are three kinds of people. Ready? On your handout. Three kinds of people. First of all, there are those who focus their financial decisions on the next 30 hours. They focus it on the next 30 hours. Whoa! Let's party! What do I want right now? What feels good right now? What's the next thing I want to get right now? And that's all they think about. They focus their financial decisions on the next 30 hours. What do I want right now? Or what feels good right now? Secondly, there are those people who focus their financial decisions on the next 30 years. Now that's wiser. I'll be honest with you, that's wiser. These are the people who are like 401k, Roth IRA, right? Stocks, bonds, savings accounts. These are people who they're thinking longer term, right? They're focusing their financial decisions on what's best for me in retirement. If you're taking notes, they're thinking retirement. And by the way, you ought to. That's right. You ought to think about retirement. You ought to plan for that. You ought to make plans in that direction. But some people focus their financial decisions entirely on what's best for the next 30 years. What good will this do me in retirement? And then I would tell you that thirdly, there are those who focus their financial decisions on what is best for the next 30 billion years. Okay? People who focus their financial decisions on what is best for eternity from now, with the idea, with an eye to see that I, the real me, am going to last forever. And the kingdom of God is going to last forever, and the people that I love are going to last forever, and the people that I can share the gospel with are going to last forever, and the people that I've never met in mission works in the Philippines and in Africa and other places, those people are going to live forever. They focus their resources and their financial decisions on the next 30 billion years. And they ask this question, what will put me in good stead in eternity? In eternity. Now, I want to try to be clear here. This is not teaching that giving saves you. Okay, I want to be exceedingly, extremely clear here, because this is one thing that people can really, truly misunderstand. Some people feel like I'm right with God because I go to church and I drop money in the offering plate, or I give every month, and then you ask them, how do you know you're a Christian? And they'll give you that kind of answer, because that's the status of their relationship. That's how they measure their relationship with the Lord. And let me tell you, salvation is not for sale for any amount of money. You can't buy a relationship with Jesus. You can't buy peace with God. Jesus bought it on the cross. With the blood he shed for you, he paid the price, and he paid it all. And God is not so much interested in your money. He could print his own. Okay, if he wanted to, he could do that. What God is interested in is your heart. And the truth is, our money's pretty tied to our heart. It is. Jesus knew this. That's why he said, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Right? That's why he said, lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. What's he talking about? He's talking about thinking long term. The next 30 billion years. Do something in such a way that when you manage your money in such a way that it's laying up treasures in heaven, instead of thinking about how can I lay it up just for retirement or just for the next 30 hours so I can make sure and have a big blowout birthday bash for the kids. You're thinking long term. Now, I want to give you a picture real quick. Can I do that? I'm going to have some helpers. Let me get Austin, will you help me? Acacia, will you help me? And over here, let's get Jonathan, would you come up and give me a hand? All right. And Samuel, will you give me a hand too? All right, would you do that? Okay, I might need Christian also. All right, come on up. All right, here's what I want to do. I'm going to take this right here, and I want Austin, I want you to be the lead man. Okay, you're going to run with that. I'm going to hold on to it. And you go with him, and I want you to stop at the corner and hold it, and he's going to keep going, okay? And you guys, let's have Samuel back there at that corner back here, and Christian back here at this corner back here. All right? And Jonathan, you're going to be at this corner right there, okay? Okay, so Samuel, hold that right there. I want you to look at this, string, and I'm gonna do an illustration, a picture here. Uh-oh, got the string, we've got it tangled. There we go, okay. Got it going again. Now, the string is wrapping all the way around here, and this is a pretty long ball of string. I could probably have these guys keep going and go right out this door and go across the street and go over there and probably could, but I'll stop them when Austin gets back up here, all right? Here's what I want to tell you. This string represents time and eternity. Okay? Why don't you hold that for me? I want to show you something. This right here, this part that I'm coloring right here on the end, you can't see that on the video back there. You may not be able to see it from the back row. But that is your life. That's your life right there. You see, right here you were born. Right there on the end. You actually graduated from high school about right there. You got married right there. You had kids right through here. You retired about right there, and then you died about right there. You say, I couldn't even see the difference. I know. You couldn't. I was only moving the pencil or the pen about that much each time. If that is your life and this is eternity, you see, you are not just that little slice right there, that little 70 years right there. That's not you. You are going to live. You see, when that 70 years is gone and you're 5, 6, 7, 8, 1,000 years later, 1,500, 2,000 years later, when you're 5,000, 10,000, 20,000 years from now, you will still be alive. You will still exist. And this is the incredible mystery of eternity. That God has said, there was a time when you did not exist, but there will never, ever again be a time where you do not exist. That you will be forever somewhere. And here's what I want to say. When you carry with you your values and you say, I'm going to be smart, I'm going to be wise, I'm going to not just plan for the next 30 hours, I'm going to plan for the next 30 years. Good, but you're still only thinking of a piece about that big. Am I making sense to you? You're saying, I'm wiser than all these other people. All they think about is who's going to party with them this weekend. I'm thinking about retirement. Oh, you poor person. That's as far forward as you thought? What a shame. So, Darrell, how do we deal with it? Guys, thank you very much. You can just drop it right where it is and go back and find it. I'm not sure. I was going to say wrap it back up, but there's no point in that, all right? Let's just drop it right where it's at, all right? Thank you, guys. I appreciate your help. Here's the point that I have to make. Your money is not yours. These are the lessons from this story. Your money's not yours. You're only here for a little while. At best, you're only here for a little while. And then you're going to be alive for a long, long time after this. And so Jesus is saying, make sure that you use what I have given you in this little test period of your existence here on earth in this body before your death. Make sure you use that money that I pass on to you wisely to make friends for the next trillion years of your life, because this life is going to end, and then who will get the stuff you thought you needed? Am I making sense to you? As Christians, our call, the call I'm making to you as believers, is to live your life not for this life, but for the next one. What I'm calling you to is to say, get your head out of the values of this world and the fog of this world, where they'll tell you one of two things: either live for the next 30 hours or live for the next 30 years. Whichever one, it's still living for this world. You're still saying the values of this world are what dictate and control my giving. And I would tell you, be like this guy in this one way, okay? Don't be like him in dishonesty, but be like him in this, that you realize, I'm not going to be here forever. Secondly, that you realize, this money's not mine anyway. When I'm done with it, it all goes anyway. So you've got to decide whether you want to think short term, which is just for the next, from now until you drop dead, or whether you want to think long term and say, I choose to make friends in heaven. And when I walk into heaven, there's going to be people there who say, you, hey, you're not going to believe this, but let me tell you what Jesus told me. He told me that you gave, and I know you've never met me before, but you gave to the missions, the mission thing at church, and I just want to tell you thank you. Thank you. There was a missionary who came and they dug a water well and they gave us clean water in our village, and then they told us about Jesus, the water of life, and I believed on him, and I'm here today because you gave. What's he saying? You're going to see people walking down the street after you leave this job, and they're going to say, oh, hey, come on in. Won't you come sit with me for a while? You're my friend. You know why? Because you gave. That is investing in forever. So here's what I want to tell you. The one thing you got to know: by the cross of Jesus, I have been saved from focusing on the things money can buy now, and set free to focus my finances on eternity by being generous. Being generous. Thank you. Yes, I spoke that too quietly. I had a friend this week. I say friend. It was a Facebook friend. You have those? Yeah? Or guys that you don't know, but you know them on Facebook, right? I had a friend who said he heard that I was preaching a series on money. And he said, yeah, those shallow messages on money He's one of these guys that's like, you can only preach about Jesus and whatever. And he said, oh, those shallow messages about money that you just, Jesus didn't die for that. Now, no, Jesus didn't die for your money, all right? He did not. He didn't die to make you, I promise you this, Jesus did not die to purchase for you with his blood a good and comfortable life. He did not. I promise you that he did not. But if he did, the problem is that he forgot to notify the Apostle Paul. Because the Apostle Paul, the greatest missionary of the early church, lived a life pouring himself out, sometimes having much because he'd have plenty to eat, other times being in jail and being beaten and being shipwrecked. But he lived his life out, and he lived it out for Jesus and poured all of it out for Jesus. Jesus did not purchase die to purchase for you a comfortable life. What he did die for was to save you from the fog and the poison of the world that says all that matters is a comfortable life now. That's what Jesus died to provide for you. He died to provide you a mindset that says all that matters is not a comfortable life now. What matters is eternity. What matters is the kingdom of God that will last forever. What matters is my eternal, never-dying soul. That is what matters. And Jesus died to set you free. No, we're not one of those just seeker-sensitive churches that says, oh, we're gonna tell you how to have a happy life and then hope that you'll maybe come back next week and give money. No, what I want to tell you is how to have a life that means something. I want to tell you how to have a life that for the next 100,000 years, the next billion years, the next trillion years is still making a difference. That's what I'm interested in. You see, when I leave this world, I probably will not leave much to my children. My grandparents did not leave much to my mom and dad. And when my parents die, they probably will not leave that much in terms of worldly goods. They will not leave that much to me. But I will promise you this, that what they gave me, you cannot buy with money. And what they gave me is a perspective on things that says, I want to know that what I do today has an impact for eternity. Used to have a little plaque right beside our door. It actually broke a while back. We used to have a little plaque right beside our door that said, only one life, 'twill soon be past, and only what's done for Christ will last. It's a good reminder. And that's what he's saying. Now, today in your handout, you got a stewardship commitment card. Now, I'm challenging not only our church, but also Servant's Heart Chapel in Clovis, New Mexico, and Carey Street Fellowship in Zanesville, Ohio. I'm challenging everybody who is here at this service to think about and take a challenge for me. Okay? I want to challenge you to something, all right? I want to challenge you to trust God and make him the Lord of your finances. And you say, "Well, how do I do that?" Well, first of all, you got to understand that he owns everything anyway. Yeah, there's got to be a mental shift to where this money, there's no money that you've ever had that's yours. And no money that you're going to get next week or the week after that, it's not yours. It's not yours. That's the first thing. It belongs to him. He can give more, or he can take it away anytime he wants. A while back, I bought one of my little kids a pack of Skittles. And I bought him a pack of Skittles, and they were sour Skittles, which are the best kind. All right, so. And so when they took it, I said, "Can I have a couple?" And I held my hand out, and they said, "Sure." And so I took them and I started to pour it, and they said, "But not too many." Excuse me, kid. If I want to, I bought you these Skittles. And if I want to, I could never buy you Skittles again. And if I wanted to, I'm not super rich, but I could buy so many Skittles, so many sour Skittles for you that your tongue would be sore and your stomach would hurt and you would never want to look at a sour Skittle again in your life. I could do that too if I wanted. I could bless you with sour Skittles every day of your life from now on. Or I could say, "I'm not getting that kid any more sour Skittles. Why are you so concerned about one little pack of Skittles and whether or not I have too many?" Some of you guys, now hear me out now, some of you guys are living your life, you're living your life and God says, "I'd like you to learn to be generous." You say, "Well, I guess I could give something, and but not too much, not too much. You're kind of freaked out by it, you know? Like, I want to challenge you to put your finances under the lordship of Jesus Christ in such a way that you know nothing you have is his. So scratch that. Nothing you have is yours. Some of them, people are like, I heard it. That's what he said. Yeah. Nothing you have is yours. And the second thing is this: I would challenge you to give, and to give regularly, and to give 10%, the first 10% of what God sends to you, give to him. It's in the scripture. There's a scripture that's based on the scripture. Does God own only 10% and you own 90? No, he owns the whole 100. But tithing is an act of faith that says, I trust God that what I give to him, he makes up the difference. And when I give, he said that somehow with God, $10 minus $1 equals $10. Somehow, that's the math. God blesses, and he gives, and he is able to provide for you. That God who can frankly give you as many Skittles as you want, as you need, as many Skittles as he wants. He could give you so much you'd be sick of it, or he could take it away and never give you any. Don't be scared of what he's of giving to God. Instead, be generous. And so here's what I'd like to do. I'd like you to offer you the opportunity today to participate in a 90-day tithing challenge. Some of you have never done this before. Never tithed before. And so if that's you, understand, no problem. Here's what I'd like you to do. I'd like you to try it for 90 days. And this is what we always do. This is true. Always do. We have always said, if you'll give in this 90-day tithe challenge in such a way that we can track what you give. Okay, so that means you give with one of the tithe envelopes, you put your name on it so we know what you get, we know who's giving and we know how much they're giving. Or you give online through our website or by a check in the offering, some way that we can track who's giving. If you'll give, if you'll say, I'm gonna tithe for 90 days, I'm gonna do that. And when I'm done with the 90 days, if at the end of the 90 days you say, you know what, God is not keeping his promise and he's not meeting my needs, I will go to the treasurer and I will say, add up everything that they've given and we'll write you a check back at the end of the 90 days. If you can honestly look at me and say, God's not providing for me, and we'll write you a check, we'll write it back. We actually put it into a set-aside, separate fund for this 90 days. One time, I had a person come to me at the end of the 90 days and say, you know what, it's not working. They called on a Saturday. They said, you know what, it's not working out, man. It's just not happening, and I'm going to need to ask you to write that back. I said, I tell you what, talk to me about it tomorrow at church. I want you to think about it. I want you to pray about it. Talk to me tomorrow at church. If you still feel the same way, we'll do it. Next day, that person came to me and said, you know what, I've been thinking about it, and actually, I do believe God's going to meet my needs. I haven't seen everything I'm hoping for, everything I'm praying for yet, but I believe God's meeting my needs. And by God's grace, that person still gives to this day. Now, I would say the reason I want you to give is not so that we can build a fancy building out here. It's not why I want you to give. The reason I want you to give is not even just because we serve 21,000 people a year through this food pantry. The reason I want you to give is not just because we have a certain amount each month that we try to use to help and bless families in our church and people outside our church. That's not why. The reason I want you to give is because I think your heart needs the materialism power breaking of giving. Jesus doesn't need your money, but he does want your heart. And when he gets a hold of your money, when he gets the lordship over the money of your life, he has your heart too. And so I just want to challenge you to do that. Some of you have been tithers for years, and you know, and you could offer testimonies. And there's a recommitment card on the back. There's a commitment card on the front. I would challenge you to sign that. Give it to me after service. Just hand it to me. Hand it in as we're going out. I'll be back by the back door. Hand it to your pastor or a person that if you're at one of our video sites. And I would just challenge you, make that commitment between you and the Lord, and let's see what God does for the next 90 days. All right? Let's bow our heads together for prayer.